Welcome back to Kevin Wilson SBC. I'm excited to get part two out today. This video is going to focus on setting up the suspension for the 48 Ford Coupe. Many of you are following along. We're going to focus today on the four link bar angles and the shock installed height coil spring compression. So today's video is going to cover what everyone is most interested in and how am I going to set up the four link on this bad boy. Please remember to subscribe to the channel. Your support is absolutely critical. It's amazing all the comments and the feedback I'm getting and the contacts I'm getting from our website. Please remember to check the description below on the YouTube video. I have lots of information in the description. I have product links. I have our shop link. I have everything you need to know about what I'm saying here in this video. So if you would, please smash the like button. Give me a thumbs up. Give me some comments. Let's jump in. As we cover the four link and the shocks on the 48 Ford, there's a couple of things that you need to keep in mind. This is a back half G-body frame. I've said that a couple times, but in case you're new and you're watching this video for the first time, it's a G-body frame and it's been back half by us. And we've installed this back half that we purchased from Checkered Racing. The description will, and the link will be in the description. The blown small block Chevrolet, we're shooting for about 1,000 to 1,100 horsepower and 1,000 foot-pound of torque. So I do believe what we have can take that, but we may have to do some beefing up. A couple things that you'll notice right off the bat on the four-link setup is we only have one top bar hole on the rear end. We don't have multiple locations on that. I wish I had some more options. However, the one hole, I do like where it's placed. It's pretty close to the axle center line here, and I think it's a pretty good location. I have four bolt holes on the rear bar location. I have three bolt holes on the front bottom bar, and I have six bolt hole locations on the top front bar. So we have some pretty good adjustment, and what you see here is how the bars are currently set. Please ignore the angles. The angles are not to scale. As a matter of fact, the top bar has a little better rake down than what you see in this picture. The bottom bar has about that angle up right now. And this is what I want to start with for our discussion today. I'm not sure I'm going to leave this four link set like this before we go out and make our first hit. I'm really heavily leaning towards this, but this breaks many rules of a big tire slick car. As you know, the general philosophy is on a big tire slick, you have to run squat. That's what everyone tells you. That's what the majority of everyone's gonna do, is they're gonna put some squat in the car. They're gonna let the rear end squat. and they're going to try to get that slick planted by using your compression and rebound settings to control that squat. I have videos on all of that discussion. However, I'm more of a guy who's trying to get a little closer to the anti-squat line and maybe even have more than 100% anti-squat in a big tire slick car. And we're going to talk more about that. Really, at the end of the day, we can argue and talk about that all we want. Until we go out to the track and make some test hits, this is all chalkboard theory. So you're going to follow along with us if you choose to, and we're going to show you when we go out to the track or wherever we go out to do some testing, you're going to see how the car reacts. You're going to see if the car squats. You're going to see if the car separates. You're going to see if we kind of do a whole lot of neither and just get most of the momentum going forward. Now let's talk about what I have set up here. I may bring some pictures in and out as we're talking about that. But currently what I have is on the bottom bar, on the rear of the bottom bar, I'm 7.5 inches to the track. I have an 11 inch spread up to the top bar, which puts my top bar rear mount to 18.5 inches from the track. If you go to the chassis mount of the four link, the front bottom is 8.875 inches off the track. The top bar frame location is 15.250 inches off the track. If you calculate all this out with my center of gravity and the height of my center of gravity, with these bar angles, I'm currently set up with the anti-squat line to run 113% anti-squat. This instant center length is 44 inches. My instant center height is 10.8 inches off the track. Now, that's how the bars are currently set with the current ride height and everything like we want the car. Let's pause for a minute and let's talk about something very critical about controlling the hit, and that's these rear coilover shocks. Today I'm running the QA1DD501s, and according to QA1, fully compressed they are 11.6 inches, fully extended they are 17 inches. Now, in the car right now, with the car loaded at ride height, ready to go, we have 14.25 inches installed height. That leaves me with 2.65 inches of compression and 2.75 inches of extension on that shock. I'm currently running coilover springs 12 HT150s at 150 pounds, and their 12-inch springs are currently compressed at 9 inches. So I have about 25% spring compression on the rear end of the 48 Ford. Let's talk a little bit more about what we just went over with the four link bar angles and the shock settings. Please remember, when we took these measurements, we had the car on those blocks I showed you, and I can show some pictures of that right here. And whenever we took our measurements, we have to remember to subtract the height of those blocks from the measurements I took. So have a simple Google sheet that I used to put together, and you can look at some of those numbers now, and you can see some very basic known calculations. First thing on the sheet you see is the height of the blocks, and then you notice I have the cam centerline height from the crankshaft centerline on a Gen 1 small block Chevrolet is 4.521. Underneath the car, it's much more accurate to measure the crankshaft centerline to the ground than trying to get up through everything else that I've got going on the front of this car to find the center line of the cam. So we use the center line of the crank, which is a very easy measurement to get while you're under the car, and then you add 4.521 to get the center line of the cam. Now, I am using the camshaft method, the cam height, for my center of gravity height. It is not an exact center of gravity, but it's close enough for me to look at the anti-squat line and get an idea of how I want to baseline the car. This 113% anti-squat number is based on those estimates. So I'm pretty sure it's close, but I want my first time out of the track to be closer to the anti-squat line than way far away from it. And then I can video the car, I can see how the car reacts, and based on that, I know what kind of bar angles or shock settings to change. So I just want to be very clear, these are not exact measurements for center of gravity and everything else. Now the wheelbase is known, and the 48 Ford wheelbase is 113 inches. We don't have any rear steer in the car. The anti-roll bar is completely neutral. As a matter of fact, when I was taking these measurements, I had the passenger side anti-roll bar disconnected. It was neutral, but I went ahead and just disconnected it anyways to make sure, and then settled the rear end out, make sure everything was settled out. So it's important to understand that I absolutely know where the center of gravity falls on the wheelbase. I know that because of my weight percentages. I know the percentage of weight on the front. I know the percentage of weight on the rear. So based on those calculations, I showed you in a previous video how to find out where the center of gravity falls on that wheelbase plot. Now the height of the center of gravity, like I said, I'm using the camshaft height method to estimate that. Now there are some people who draw that neutral line or anti-squat line to that from the center of the slick path to that center of gravity. You can do that. You can draw that anti-squat line to the center of gravity spot. You can draw that anti-squat line to the center of the front spindle at the height of the center of gravity. I choose to use the anti-squat line that runs from the center of the slick to the front spindle center line at the height of my camshaft. It's not that one way is more right than the other. It just gives you a starting point to understand where your instant center length and height falls in relation to whichever line you're using. And then you go out to the track and you make some test hits and you do some very good video of the side of the car, and then you see what the car's doing at the track. Based on that, you now know what direction to go with your instant center length and height, and you know what change will put more separation in the car or less separation, more squat or less squat in the car. That's totally your call. But I want to show you everything about the 48 Ford, and right now this is how the bars are set. And right now I'm leaning heavily to leaving the bars at these angles. We'll probably start off with around 10 pounds of air pressure in these slicks, and we're going to go out probably and see what it does. I'm probably going to foot brake the car for the first couple of hits. Let's talk about that. On my first time out with this setup, you can see I'm pretty neutral. I've got the shocks pretty much set in the center of their travel. I got double adjustable shocks, so I have compression and rebound settings. That's a separate video. I'm going to talk about where I'm going to start with those in the next video. I got my bar angle set. I'm not running a crazy amount of anti-squat or less than 100% anti-squat. I'm pretty close. You know, this may actually be 120% if my measurements are a little off on the center of gravity. You know, if you use the center of the slick to the center of gravity, this is going to be less than 100% anti-squat, and the car may squat some. And I'm going to have to go out and see how the car reacts with these bar angles. I said I was going to foot brake the car on the first couple hits, and I'm probably going to get some questions about why. Well, like I said, I'm kind of wondering, with the kind of horsepower we're making and the torque we're making with this Roots blower, the torque is immediate. When you stab it, I'm going to go from 0 pounds of boost to about 22 pounds of boost in less than a second. And I can show you that on one of my Fuel Tech charts, where I actually did a stab of this car in the driveway at the shop. that, you can see the curve, the boost curve, make a very quick ramp. So also, I need to get an idea of the plugs. I need to understand, are we fat? Are we lean? Are we close to good? How does the plugs look as far as timing? How does the plug look as far as heat range? So I'm not interested on my first hit down the track of coming up on the two-step, letting go of the button, and let it eat. I'm gonna go out and I'm gonna foot brake the car for the first couple of passes, and I'm gonna run through the first gear, hit second, lift, kill the motor, and come around to the pits, read the data, pull some plugs, take some readings. By doing that, I'm also going to understand, how is this Sportsman 4-link, how is it going to hold up to the hit? It's not that 1,000 horsepower or 1,100 horsepower and 1,000 foot-pounds of torque is that unusual these days. That's actually very tame. It's just, I'm doing all this, and once the car has everything back on it, I'm going to be over 3,400 pounds. So when you take that kind of a hit and that kind of a shock on that heavy of a car, all of these components are under a lot more stress. They're getting hit a lot harder. The drive shaft, the axles, everything is getting hit a lot harder to get 3,400 pounds moving down the track. To summarize, I'm considering, and I would love for your comments back. It'd be really interesting to see what you guys think. Do you think I'm crazy running 113% anti-squat on a big tire slick? Do you think I should move this bottom bar front mount down one hole and definitely put squat in it? If I were to move this bottom bar down one hole, my instant center length goes to about 60, and I'm about 65% anti-squat. Not only that, the instant center length is pretty much right directly under the center of gravity of the car. So, you know, probably going to do some pretty strong wheel stands on something like that. And I really don't want to kill these wheelie bars. So, interesting. I'd love to get your thoughts and comments on what would you do with these bar angles on the first trip out in a car that's over 3,400 pounds with 1,100 horsepower and 1,000 foot-pounds of torque. As soon as you smash the throttle, that torque is coming in right off the bat. That boost is there on this 871 blower shop blower. So right now, here's the settings we have on the car. No secrets. All of my measurements are right here. You can see the spread in the front and the rear. Many guys focus less on all this stuff. They focus more on rear spread and front spread. So, you know, 11 inch spread on the rear. And I got 6.375 spread up front. So I got a spread of 6.375 on the front, and I got an 11 inch spread on the back. So for you guys that are more concerned about understanding what's the rear spread, what's the front spread, there you have it. No secrets. That's exactly what the 48 Ford has right now. I believe I can have a better 60 foot time with more than 100% anti-squat, getting the physics and the energy of that rear end as it twists and drives forward. As that rear end twists and drives the car forward, I'm going to make more use of that energy pushing the car down the track versus spending so much time separating or so much time squatting and adjusting these shocks and springs to just try to overcome that and slow it down. I would rather see if I can get this car launched with 113 to 120% anti-squat. I believe I will have a better 60 foot time with that versus squat in the car. And then using the compression rebound settings to help control the reaction of the car. This is everything about the 48 Ford that I can disclose to you right now. I'm not holding back any information from you at all on the 48 Ford. Thanks so much for watching. Please remember to subscribe to the channel. I hope you understand how a lot of people don't share these details on their race car. I'm trying to put fun back into racing again. So that's why I'm trying to let you guys learn from me. I may go out to the track and this may be a total failure, and you'll get to see it. And I'll make some changes. We'll regroup. We may go out to the track and this may be a huge success for the 48 Ford. Every car is different. And please remember, it's about the combination. It's about the front end and the rear end and the springs and the shocks and the valving and the bar angles and the horsepower and the torque. It's about the entire combination working together. That's my rant. Hey guys, let's remember there's three things we're always shooting for. We want to go fast, we want to go straight, and we want to be safe.